want to talk about first about there are many private and very intimate moments in the film. How did the production team get the trust of Weijia, his family, and the community?
这拍片的过程中有很多比较私密的这样子一个片段，那这整个工作人员和导演和您怎么跟这些家庭和他们的社群和他们的主人取得一个这样的信任，然后我们在他们镜头上可以很自然地发挥。首先我觉得就是北方那边这些少数民族他们本身面对人的时候就没有虚伪，一点都没有。 所以在我第一次见他们的时候，他面对我也没有感觉到说面对摄影机的时候说面前有这个东西存在对我会不自然。So
I do think that for people from the north, especially for these ethnic minorities from the north and in the north, northern China, they tend to be very, very honest, and they're not pretentious, and they somehow had this natural way of relating to the cameras. So I do think that that's why one of the reasons why they seem so natural.
You actually told me a very interesting story, how you earned the trust of the members. Can you briefly tell us about that story?
简短说一下，就像片子里看的，我们跟他们就像干那个下大雪的时候干重活，就经常我拍完那个镜头很短，我也就回去跟他们干活了。所以这样就跟他们一起干活，经常这样子。然后有的时候就晚上我们有一次，晚上我们就三个人，其中的那个和老大就打人的那个人，然后还有另外一个人，片子里没有出现，我们一起去。 带着两把枪去打猎，然后到了一个地方以后就都喝了酒了，然后他们俩就发生了一点争执。So
the shot that you saw, that was very, very heavy snow, and they had a lot of work to do. So actually, after I shot that particular scene for a short period of time, I actually joined them to work along with them. A lot of hard labor things that I participate in. And also with that, one night, three of us actually, including the front man that you saw with the one hitting Weijia in the film, that three of us, along with another person who's not in the film, that we went out and we brought two rifles and we went hunting and we drank together. And in the middle of the night, they actually got into an argument.
因为他们俩都有枪，所以我感觉到就是要他们俩要可能要打起来，所以我当时就说必须做一个决定，因为如果真打起来的话，我躲在一边也可能也躲不过，或者是我得把这个架子拦下来，因为我在中间，所以我当时就一下子确定，那我就拦住这个大一点年龄的这个人。So
since both of them actually carry a gun, and I was sort of caught in the middle and trying to somehow resolve the conflict. And I really thought at the time that they really will start shooting each other because of it. So I decided to somehow manage to deal with the bigger guy first, which is...
然后因为我抱住他，我知道他年龄大一点，所以他能把这个火气，他更理性一点，所以他压住一点，我就一直在抱着他，所以他们一直在嚷。然后因为中间有一个汽车，所以我们躲在这个汽车中间。然后突然，另外一个人就朝着我们这边开枪了，就从那个子弹就从这个身边就过去了。当然是那个小一点的那个枪。So
Which is the older guy that I approached, another bigger guy. Since he's older, hopefully he will be more, I can reason with him. He will be more calm with the situation. So as we approach him, actually we were sort of in between two cars and we were hiding there, and the other person actually shot a bullet towards us, and it just, it's really, really close, and it almost hit us.
这时候我听到枪一响，我就想 OK，他一开了枪，那我抱着这个人肯定就更生气。但是我抱着他，所以他也转不过去，他也不能拿这个枪去打对方。对方一看打了枪，所以他觉得他也发泄了一点。然后至少有一个人中间在拉架，所以是打不起来的。然后这个时候就差不多就慢慢的就平息了这个事情。Since
I was with the bigger guy, then I was actually holding him. That's why he couldn't actually return fire towards the other person. And I think that the other person, since that he shot, you know, fired the first shot and somehow vent out whatever frustration that he had. So that's actually eventually how we resolved the conflict because of that particular incident.
然后这个时候就差不多平息了。 因为你在片子里面看到那个人打那个人，打完第二天他们就又好一起了。晚上就是平息了差不多，过了半个多小时都静下来，然后我们就互相在一起又回去了。So
it almost has never happened. We just drank together again, and then as you can see, the next day everything seems to be fine. And so I thought that. That could be a turning point in terms of how we bond together because of that particular life and death situation.
So they, I think that they looked at me, and 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 they looked
So to them, the bonding moment has a lot to do with the way that they see me as someone who's not from their culture, but I'm willing to risk my life to put myself in a particular situation, because for them, rifles, guns are something very natural to them, but it's completely foreign to me. And they really see that as a way that I'm really trying to become part of their culture, and therefore I earn their trust.
I think that the film conveys a lot of compassion for Weijia's pain. And he's actually quite a lovable guy. I mean, he's very poetic, and he's filled with passion. But he's often shown drunk, and he gets into fights. I'm wondering what sort of consideration went into making the film to avoid audience misunderstanding, to avoid the audience judging him, or taking him for a joke.
关心怜悯同情的这样的一个角度去看维嘉，那影片中也有很多他喝醉酒啊，他打架的这样的状况。那当初在拍这部片或者在剪辑这部片的时候，是有什么样的考虑，让这些观众对维嘉这个人物不会有一些当当做他是一个玩笑，或者是觉得他是一个很负面的一个这样的一个人物？
剪辑的时候，我们其实这个剪辑上，后来我们看也可能是对大众有点不是交代的太明白的这个，因为我们本身做片子的时候，就没把它当成是一个，就是有一点点这种。 别人看他是个酒鬼这样一个人，我们也没这样认为他，所以剪辑的时候就是这样顺利的这样的剪下去。后来，
So in terms of the editing and the shooting process of this particular film, I do think that looking back that we didn't really make it very clear to the general audience about this particular character, and to us. We really don't see him as a drunkard, and we just pretty much follow his life as it goes, as it's unfolding. So that's sort of our approach is not to somehow categorize him in any way. It's just he's being himself.
所以后来有人提议说, 他是不这种是一个酒鬼，他是不已经在自己的这个思维里面已经是不正常了。我们就突然学到，我说啊，怎么会有这种想法？他说，那你怎么片子里面他都在一种完全的状态里？我说，喝了酒就会是这样。但是你看他那种对诗的，他写的那些诗，然后你看他写诗的时候那种思考，我觉得他是完全平时是很理性，没有一点点自己有问题的这样的那种思考。
So when we showed the clips that we actually had to some friends and people, and they mentioned to us that and sort of really surprised us to know that they see him as someone who is so such an alcoholic that they see him as someone who is delusional all the time or most of the time and cannot be taken seriously. But the way we see him and we saw him was very, very different, because when we saw the way that he wrote the poems and the way that he did his artwork, that he was very, very thoughtful and very, very rational. And so it comes as a surprise to us that people see him as someone who is completely out of his mind because of alcohol.
I want to ask, talk a little bit about representation. You and the director are not from the community, you're not part of the Ewenti community. And I'm wondering, did you think about much about how to represent the people and also to be able to give them an authentic voice?
No. 导演和您本身不是他们的主人，那在影片中呈现他们这样一个状况下，是如何让他们有最真实的这样一个声音可以表达？我们拍片的时候，就是那种因为。 我们去拍的时候是方式是不一样的，就是不是一到那就拍，我们是跟他们就是生活在一起，然后每天都大家一起喝酒吵，然后什么的，然后自然的时候就把这个摄影机拿起来，然后平时我们会聊很多，就是关于社会上这些现象，然后电影里面要说什么，所以他们看起来好像已经知道我们在要，我们是在。
我们是来干嘛的？So
when we shot the film, we didn't actually went there and then start shooting and start capturing all those moments. Well, what we did is that we live with them, we live among them, and we drank with them, we got into fights with them, and so when we see that there's a moment that we can really present them in the most natural state, then we will actually then start shooting. We will then put up the camera and to capture those moments. So I do think that because that the way that we talk to them, because we interact with them, talking about many different things, political issues, talking about movie films, I think that, that they really have, they understand what we're there to do, and they really sort of put down their guards and really show their the most honest and authentic side of them to us.
I understand that Aoluguya has now been turned into a tourist destination, and the people there are kind of on display for the tourists. Can you talk about the situation there now, mm-hmm. how it's like?
那现在奥卢古亚那边已经变成一个观光 圣地，那好像去的人就他们已经变成是陈列品，或者像去他们去被当做是动物园这样去看了。那现在的状况是怎么样？我分享一下。
我们已经有差不多一年多没去了，然后前也就来美国之前的 两个星期，就是片子里面那个女的，就是她的那个妹妹的孩子，在北京上学，来告诉我说，那个维嘉现在就是特别特别特别的不开心，她还想再回到这个南方去找她那个女朋友。我说为什么呀？她说她现在在当地现在是名人了。我说那名人不是挺好的吗？
So we haven't been back for almost a year, well, more than a year. And 2 weeks before I came to the United States, and I got some information from the child of the sister of Weijia. And she's right now in Beijing studying. And she told me that actually Weijia really wanted to go back to the South to visit the girlfriend again, and the reason for it is because he sort of has become quite a celebrity in the village, and then he didn't like the attention and the situation he is in right now back in Aoluguya.
然后我说，那他不是就是已经是名人了？他的因为他的画现在卖的都挺好的，好多人买他的画，他是艺术家。然后。他就觉得这太没意思了，做成这样的艺术家，人们对我这种，就是他成了一种好像把我自己的那种东西，其实他就觉得你没有不懂的来欣赏这些东西，你只是觉得啊、哦、这个地方出名了，你们来看我，所以他这个维嘉现在已经很难受的在那待着。
And he couldn't stand the fact that even though he's a very famous painter now in Aoluguya, but at the same time, most people came here because of not because of his work, it's because he's famous. And they couldn't, these people, most of them, they don't even understand his work, but they see him as a celebrity, and he thinks that this is something completely nonsense. And he can't stand it, and he really wants to go back to Sanya to.His girlfriend.
然后现在整个那个奥卢古亚，他们是，我们看到了那个后来有一个木头的房子。然后刚开始片子的时候看到一个红色的房子，所以那个2003年那个红色的房子是政府花钱盖的，那个房子就是后来用了，就政府全部花钱几十万盖了60多座房子，让他们住。那个是2003年盖的。然后2012年的时候，政府就把那60多座房子全部拆了，所以政府要做旅游，就把这个地方变成一个旅游的地方。然后政府把那60多座房子都拆了以后，又盖成了现在这种，木头的房子，每一座好价70多万这个人民币。
So.The opening scene of the film, you saw those wooden structures, and these are actually the original settlement built by the government in 2003. There are about maybe more than 60 wooden structures there with like a reddish colors. And these structures actually have been torn down in 2012 when the government decided that this will be turned into a tourist site.And now they have torn down all those wooden structures. They built a lot of new structures there now. And these new structures, new developments, cost actually 70万、
嗯、
About, in terms of renminbi, that would be 700,000 a piece for a very, very luxury developer.Development that they are
doing.
Developed
for tourism.
For tourism. And it's, yeah.
然后现在这些房子它是那种二层的，所以政府就鼓励当地做一些工艺品，花树皮啊，然后民族服装，就是，然后因为中国政府现在在叫一种主导旅游，意思就是在其他地方，比如说其他的城市、其他的小镇，他们会组织好多单位的人来这个地方旅游，坐一大巴士车人，然后到那个地方，就可能离那个地方300-400公里，或者是几百公里，这些人来就参观他们，然后就到那个地方以后就看，哦，你们长得是这样子的呀，
So for this new development that I put together, this new tour site that I put together, they really encourage the people in the village to start making handicrafts and to make traditional costumes and to sell and to display them in these new loft that they have been built for them. And the government also trying to somehow really focus on the tourism industries, and they will put together buses to ship or to actually take people around to different sites. And this is one of the sites that they will stop, and they came with all those big buses, and they come down and they will look around. They will almost like going to a zoo to see exotic animals. So they will stare at them and say, wow, you're so different from us. And then for the these Ewenti people, so they really feel as if that we are human, just, you know, all the same. Why are you staring at us or looking at us in such a way that almost exoticizes us, as if we are something that is out of this world?
然后现在就是那个就刚才那个他那个妹妹那个孩子前两天告诉我，因为这个地方现在旅游已经很多人了，就是他越来越出名，媒体这些关注呀什么越来越出名，也好多人有人去，就开始去他们这儿旅游哪儿都去。然后政府现在看了这个旅游就是比较赚钱，所以政府现在有可能要做一个基，反正已经跟这些人说了，说要。 给就是让每一家人给他们一些钱，就让你们申请说谁要楼房。如果你们要楼房的话，可能会很便宜，几万块钱。如果你们开始报名的话，你们就可以得到一个楼房，很便宜，要比你们自己买便宜。我觉得如果这样的话，就有可能让他们住的这个楼房里面呢，这个房子有可能就是又不是他们的了，因为这个房子本身也是政府盖的。
So as I talked to the sister's child that recently, they said that because the Chinese government realized that there are so many tourists that wanted to go to this place, and they have a lot of revenues coming in, so they are thinking about actually relocating again these people from this particular tourist site to a sort of satellite cities and to encourage them to buy these modern housing with a cheaper price tag for them. And I do think that maybe that's the next thing, is that they might actually be asked to leave that particular tourist site to live in these new settlements, quote unquote, these new housing project that they built around the tourist site.
Well, let's take some questions from the audience. We have mics that we can pass. Someone right in the middle.
Thank you so much. I really was very moved by the film. And I was wondering, at the beginning there's a dancing scene. And is that sort of entertainment exported from outside the village, or is that some sort of cultural expression of the Ewenti people?
看不见不平衡，受到感动。他一开始电影的时候那些唱歌跳舞那些娱乐的一些场面，这些是当地的族人还是这是外来的汉人，然后当作是温克族的文化这样来跳舞。不好意思，我们觉得这个片子剪的实在是有一点让人感觉不到这种，其实这个是中国政府对 少数民族做的一种很典型的一个对外宣传的一个事情。当地当然有这种节日，哪一个节日？但是政府做这个事情，唯一的就是要政府来做这个事情，让 人来观赏，然后告诉人们我们的这个民族过得很快乐，很开心，唱歌跳舞。
嗯哼。但是跳舞的人还是主人。
那些太多，大部分都是那些他们找来的演员啊什么的，基本上没有族人，族人很少很少。
So I have to apologize that I guess we didn't really explain it very, very clearly in the film. Actually, this is very, very typical what the Chinese government do with these minorities or ethnic minorities in China is that they will create these type of promotional images that, of course,going along with the festivals that they celebrate, then they will put on a show for the tourists to see, and most of them are actually actors and actresses being hired to do the dancing and the singing, and very, very few of them are actually from the Ewenti tribe. So that's pretty much to show the world or show the people that how happy they are to enjoy their life and enjoy their new settlement.
This one in the center here.
Two related questions. If you could tell us, what was the government's initial justification for the relocation and taking away the Ewenti's rifles, which...I assume they weren't too happy about. So how did the government justify doing that? And your film, while it's very objective, just showing what's happening in reality, it's at least implicitly critical of the government policy. So I'm curious if it's been screened in China and what kind of reaction it got.
那说当初为什么会有像这样政府的理由到底是什么？要有生态移民啊，要把枪，把它完全从族人的手中拿，把它拿掉。那它的理由是什么？那第二个问题是，虽然是以很客观的方式去表达这样子一个故事，但是主观方面是对政府是非常有很强烈的质疑和评议。那在这部片在中国的话是可以放映吗？然后如果有放映的话，受到什么样的回响？很反应。那第一个就是政府的理由是为什么要做生态？
他们当时是就是说要禁止打猎，因为就是当时那些城市里面，就是那个森林里面的猎物已经不多了。然后也没有理由，你知道他们做事情说让你不干什么就不干什么了，只是跟他们说用这样的一个方式说，我们先停止一段时间打猎，然后。你不用担心你们的生活，我们会帮助你们吃喝呀什么的。然后，如果过一段时间，几年或者是多少年，这个动物们又多起来了，又恢复了，我们再把这个枪还回去。是用这样的方式跟他们说的。当时
，So for the hunting part, the government pretty much they will just tell you what you should do without giving a lot of reasons, but one of the excuse or justification they gave the tribal members are that right now there are not a lot of games or animals in the forest, so we should stop for maybe a couple years. When we do have more animals for you to hunt, then we will give you back your guns. But that's the reasons that trying to justify the fact that they are taking the guns away. 那这个生态移民呢，为什么把它移掉？
这就是同时，这是2003年做的这个决定，就是首先是有生态移民的这个想法，说让他们就是说法就是想让他们搬离这个他们住的地方，然后搬到离城市的地方，这样好管理。然后，但是他们原来是猎民，所以他们还有枪，所以必须得让他们交枪。那么交枪的话，不能说你什么理由，所以我们就要。跟他们说这个，说先进一段时间猎，然后我们去住到那个山下，以这样的方式才让他们交了枪，才把他们就怎么讲骗到了现在住的地方。
So they're very closely connected together in terms of why they are relocated or forced to be relocated. It's because in order to justify the fact that you need to stop hunting and we will provide you with whatever you need so that the justification is to say, therefore, you should be relocated to this particular resettlement or settlement so that we can take care of you, can provide whatever you need, and you don't need to hunt, you can still survive. So that sort of go together hand in hand, and they did that in 2003, almost like a package deal. Yes.
Oh, sorry.
只能是地下放映，就是不经过政府的放映场所，当然政府是首先纪录片也没有一个，就是如果你要经过政府的放的话，首先你得跟他们申请我们在拍这个片子，把这个送给他们，得到申请，也才有可能在影院上映，但是基本上这个是没有可能的，我们做的时候也没做说我们要准备在这个政府指定的地方放映，所以就是完全独立的这种运行在中国里面，然后放过一些，只能在地下小这种场合放映。
So, as a documentary filmmaker, or for most documentary filmmakers, that this is a route that we have to take, knowing that there's no way that we can show this or have major theater release, because if that were to be the case, we actually need to submit before we shoot a film for censors and for approval. So, what we can do and what we can only do right now is to show these films almost like underground screenings that we can do without going through the sort of the apparatus of the government system.
那反应是怎么样？就是大家都觉得怎么还有这样的一个事情，然后其实对大家都特别理解，就觉得很不奇怪了。 大家唯一就不觉得这个他们成为这个样子，就是说他们为什么受枪了，为什么不能打猎了，这样都没有这样的问题，因为觉得大家都在中国，都知道这是一个就是政府的这个手，就说你们我让你们干嘛，你们干嘛，就不奇怪这个，唯一就觉得说，可惜，就觉得这他们这样真的是太可惜了。
So a lot of them, they didn't know about what's going on. So they were shocked to learn that this is actually going on. But at the same time, they also don't feel this as something that they cannot relate to, or it's very strange to them. Actually, they think that they understand why the government did what it did. And this is something that they have seen being done to other minorities. And on a sort of very interesting reaction, on the one hand, they were shocked about it. What's happening and what's going on, but at the same time, they also didn't find it strange because they're so desensitized by this because it's been going on for quite a while for a lot of other ethnic minorities.
So we're going to take one last question over there.
First of all, I admire the main character. He's virtually a man of arts and letters, you know, and he's proof of how, you know, their potential, the potential of this people. And I mean, if they go past his physical, his alcohol, problem, and I mean, it's like when some civilized people brand other people as uncivilized, when in fact they have a high degree of being civilized, but not given credit to it. Now my question is, it's painful to see them struggle with alcohol abuse. But you kind of understand that they're coping, you know, as a result of being pulled out of their habitat, their cultural, unique cultural activities. But they're thrust upon an environment where alcohol is so readily available. I was, even in the forest, there seemed to be quite an access to it. Even in times when there didn't seem to be much income, yet there was always alcohol. What was really the situation like?
他说，在部片里面，韦家这个角色或人物其实是非常有文化的一个人。虽然说，一方面是那个文明的人想要在他 在他身上就是有一个这样的烙迹，他是一个酒鬼，然后好像是把他当做一个很不文明的，但是其实他是一个非常非常有思路和思绪和文化的人。那似乎在影片看到这个酒，一直是一个非常容易得到、非常随处都可以看到、随处都可以取到的这样的一个东西。那现在真正的状况是怎么样？是真的有这么普遍泛滥吗？因为他们自己受到被
被移民，然后被文化被侵略，然后被夺走这样的一个状况，他们就是借酒消愁嘛。我们从06年到13年，就是我们拍片子的这个之间，我们片子里面出现的，因为还有别的片子，有几部片子这里面没有出现，我们认识了，我们从开始认识到最后，我们成了朋友。 我们亲眼见到的已经有5个我们的朋友，都是我们的朋友，他们因为喝酒，全部是因为喝酒，死了。然后现在在当地，除了那些永远不喝酒的人，或者是只喝一点，大部分就是剩下的还是每天就是喝酒，因为随便就可以买到，如果在这个定居点。
随便，任何地方都可以买到，
也大家还是就是，我觉得就像他说的，就是都有那个心态，就我没有路了，我什么都没了，就是我整个的内心就空空的了，就所以我可能没有勇气去另外的一个方式去死，所以呢，我就这样，就拿酒就每天浇愁，然后哪一天就离开这个世界。
So we actually shot this film from 2006 to 2013, and there are actually a couple films we did during this time as well. And the people we actually personally interact with during this time, 5 of them we personally involved, actually they died from alcohol consumptions and alcoholism. So I do think that this is rather pervasive. So for people in the settlement, unless that these are the people who will never drink at all, or people will only drink a little bit, but the majority of them, they actually do drink heavily and regularly. And I do think that just like Weijia mentioned in the film, that when you have taken everything away, or everything you know, everything that you have cherished been taken away, you have nothing to lose. You have nothing more to lose. And a lot of them, they really see this as a way to die. And they don't know how else they can kill themselves other than going through the process of drinking and drink themselves to death.
Well, you are leaving tomorrow, going back home. Do you have some final words for the audience in New York?
明天就要离开美国了。那对纽约这些朋友有没有什么最后想要分享的一些话？ I really want our friends here to pay closer attention to the human rights violations in China and take a stand and do something about it.
Please.
Thank you.
Thanks, Zhao Jiewei. Thank you, Vincent. Thanks for coming.